possession and his are prized. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. And so heaven makes flood like an awful sinking.
Just turning your Bibles, opening your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1. We'll spend a few minutes in verse 17. But I'll read from verse 15. I'm reading the New King James Version of the Bible. Ephesians 1. From verse 15. Paul says, therefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. And verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Verse 17 says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. If you want to give the word a title, it's paradigm shift. Paradigm shift. A paradigm shift is simply a change in focus, the way you look at things. God showing you a new way. We're believing that in a few minutes there'll be a paradigm shift in our hearts, in Jesus' name. Because if you look at Ephesians 1:17, and the Holy Spirit will open your eyes. The truth is, a few minutes will not do this verse of Scripture any justice. So we can pay attention. He introduces, he says, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ. He knows that you know who Jesus is. How awesome, how powerful, how dynamic, how divine Jesus is. So he introduces God. He says, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ. Then he goes on to talk about this God, the Father of glory. He says, may give to you. Proverbs 4:7 says, get wisdom. Now he's saying God will give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. And my prayer is that this will be our portion today. That God in his mercy will give to us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. He says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, the Father of glory. Brethren, we know that glory. If I were to define glory, I'll simply say glory is experiencing, expressing, and manifesting Jesus. I'll say glory is experiencing Jesus, expressing Jesus, and manifesting Jesus. His freshness, his power, his grace, his glory, his nature. So when the glory of God comes upon a man that is given to drink, the Spirit of God, the presence of God, when Jesus rests on a man that is given to drink, suddenly he won't need brandy to be happy. The one that curses, whose speech turns the air blue, suddenly won't curse again. The one that steals will somehow realize that with God all things are possible. And he'll stop stealing. And on we could go. So glory, in a nutshell, is experiencing, expressing, and seeing the manifestation of Jesus. And my prayer is that this God of glory will do some more for us today in Jesus' name. And he goes on to say that he'll give you wisdom. We know wisdom, Proverbs 4:7, is the principal thing. We define wisdom as being led by the Holy Spirit, hearing the Holy Spirit, him leading you, you obeying, makes you wise, gives you wisdom beyond your years, gives you access to things that you know nothing about, because God knows every single thing. So if you're going to be wise, let God lead you. Like we heard earlier on, he may not do it your own way, but whatever way he does it is a whole lot better than your own way. So wisdom is just yielding to God. Wisdom is being led by the Holy Spirit. desiring to please God, desiring to get better. Brethren, none of us is perfect, not one of us. But wisdom means that you want your tomorrow to be better than your today. Wisdom means you acknowledge that God is the all-knowing God, the all-powerful God. With God, nothing is impossible. And letting the Holy Spirit lead you how God wants you to be led. You know, wisdom is serving God how he wants to be served, not how we want to serve him. My prayer is that as he gives us this wisdom, we will receive wisdom in Jesus' name. Wisdom means remaining undercover. Whatever it takes, we remain undercover. And the only way to please God, the only way to know God, the only way to be wise is to be led by the Holy Spirit. Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 9 to 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 9 to 11. And I said the other day, well, I think it was last Sunday, I said from time to time, I tell some people what I know God is saying, and then they begin to argue. Once they start to argue, I just back off. You tell a man he has mouth odor. I mean, the Holy Spirit doesn't even need to reveal that to you. One of your senses will tell you that, the sense of smell. And the man begins to argue, I brushed my teeth this morning. I used mouthwash this morning. What's that? Your mouth is smelling. He begins to argue. If he argues, don't listen, because he's not going to pay attention, and he's not going to change. Do we understand that? When we're talking about getting closer to God, the wise man, the one that will be wise, talking about wisdom, takes on board even what you know is not right. If someone comes and says to me, your jacket is extremely rough, and I know my jacket isn't rough, I will take on board what they have said. If I get the opportunity to be in a room by myself, I'll take my jacket off and look at the back. Maybe the back is rough. As I look at the front, it's not crumpled. But this person, the point is you take on board everything, you check with God. Is God in it? Or is God preparing you for something? Is God giving you advice on something that hasn't happened yet? Take everything on board. Am I going to take my jacket off, put it on the chair, and then Pastor Bobby's going to come sit beside me and sit on the jacket? The jacket isn't rough now, but in 10 minutes it could be rough. Do we understand? So you take on board everything. Check with God. Don't argue. And then let God tell you the position. That's wisdom. God will give us wisdom in Jesus' name. But let's turn in our Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 9. The word of God says, "But as it is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him." It says, no one has a clue about what God has prepared for those that love God. It says, "But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God." So if we're going to be wise, if we're going to succeed, we need an intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that tells us how to worship God, who God is, what God wants. You know, there's a story, it was a prayer point last week. Genesis 27, verse 4. This is Isaac speaking. And he says, "Make me savory food to Esau, such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die." The man says, "You know the food I love." He says, "Make that food. Give it to me and see if I won't bless you." You know, if you look at that, like the prayer point was, the only way you can make food that will please God is if the Holy Spirit helps you. Because the Holy Spirit is the one that knows what God wants. And if the Holy Spirit will help you, God must bless you. If the Holy Spirit leads you, God must bless you. There's no way. Look at what a man is saying to his son. "Make me food, the kind of food you know that I love. Bring it to me that I may eat. And my soul will bless you." The same way, let the Holy Spirit lead us. You see, our flesh leads us a lot. And flesh always leads us into trouble. Always leads us into trouble. There are some arguments we have that if we take time out to reflect, we'll realize that that was the flesh. There's some reaction that we know is the flesh. This morning I stepped out of cover. And someone that loves me noticed, you can't afford to miss it. You cannot afford to let the anointing depart. He came quickly and took over and gave me enough time to go and repent. You see, this God that we serve, if we will serve him as he ought to be served, things will change for us. You know, the truth about life is, the opinion I have of myself is totally different from everybody else's opinion of me. We may agree in some areas, but in some other areas, there may be things about myself I'm not even aware of that people see. Do we understand? So from time to time, let people speak into your life and don't resist. Even if it doesn't make sense, like I said, go back to the Holy Spirit. And as you go back to the Holy Spirit, he will sort you out. Brethren, this God, it is folly for any man to think he knows better than God. God himself knows how to complete us. Talking about a paradigm shift. Talking about the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory. The one that gives to us the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of revelation. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 8, the Bible says, don't be like them. It says, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. Even before you pray, he knows what you need. Because in Isaiah 46, 10, it says, he declares the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done. God knows the end. He knows what will happen to you tomorrow. So wisdom dictates that I stay with this God. Wisdom dictates that I let the Holy Spirit lead me. Because the one leading me knows what will happen in 2019 if I'm still alive. So why can't I trust my tomorrow to his care? Isaiah 65, 24. The Bible says in Isaiah 65, verse 24, it shall come to pass that before the call, God says, even before you call, he will answer. And while they are still speaking, he will hear. Ephesians 3, 20 to 21 talks about a God that is able to do for us more than we can ask, think, or imagine. Yesterday, a lady had a bit of an altercation with her husband, and they had a disagreement, and she left the house. And both of them are my spiritual children, by God's grace. And as she left the house, her husband is a pastor. And she thought the only person she can talk to is me, so she called. I said, I'm not reporting your son. But this is the situation. And as she spoke and they had an issue, you won't believe that by the time she got back home, God had moved ahead of both of us and he had restored what they thought was lost. Brethren, God knows the end from the beginning. With God, there is never any mistake. If we learn to just trust God, and that's all I said to her, just trust God. Don't get angry. Don't carry offense against your husband. Just trust God. And a few minutes later, she said, oh, she's totally forgiven him. Oh, all will be well. And I said, that's the only way the power of God will flow. By the time she got home, she sent me a text praising this amazing God. Brethren, if we'll trust God, we'll fight less. If we'll trust God, we'll get angry less. If we'll trust God, it'll be well with us. And then can you imagine an entire church of people that trust God? We will experience heaven on earth. An entire church of people that don't gossip. An entire church of people that don't backbite. An entire church of people that are exhibiting the fruit of the Spirit. Brethren, we will not experience heaven on earth. There has to be a paradigm shift. And that is my dream. We will get there. In Jesus' name. Because like the Bible says God gives. So if God decides to make it happen, it's a small thing for God. Because with God, absolutely nothing is impossible. I spoke about gift and spirituality. And one of the biggest things in Christianity is, and there's a place for it. There's a place for it. But gift and spirituality shows when it comes to prayers. We say praise God. And we praise him. We praise him. We praise him. And then we talk about the enemy from our Father's house that doesn't want us to prosper. Let's pray against that enemy. And suddenly we become violent. The kingdom suffers violence. The violent take it by force. That's when we remember that. And we begin to fight. Brethren, Ephesians 1:17 is talking about revelation. When God blesses you with revelation, you'll appreciate that praise is God's food. Answering the prayer of petition is God's grace. Which one do I want? To give him his food or to ask for his mercy? If I give him his food, he will sort me out. But if I'm constantly, you can't have a friend that is always asking. every day asking. He sees you, can you give me a ride? He sees you, can I come to your house for food? He sees you, I like your shoes, can I take your shoes? He sees you, this jacket is my size, can I take it? He sees you, this tie must follow me home. When you see him, you'll avoid him. When you have a friend that shows you love, a friend that is there, a friend that understands you, a friend that you can trust, you can rely on, a friend that you know has your back, when you see him, or even when you receive, you know, you can be in a state of slight irritation, not annoyed. The Bible says anger lies in the bosom of fools. So you can be allowed to be slightly irritated. That's where I am, but God is taking me from that place. He has taken me from anger to slight irritation. Gradually, I'm becoming more like Jesus. So you can be in a state of slight irritation, and somebody sends you a text, and unconsciously you smile. You haven't even seen the text, but you just see the person's name. You know? And that's how it ought to be for us. But we are in a place where we're always, when it comes to asking God, with God, nothing is impossible. Ask, seek, knock. We know all those Bible passages. That's why I'm surprised. Every Sunday, nobody has started quoting those things. But it's gift versus spirituality. So you see a person that can hold the microphone, and when it comes to prayers, I was sharing with Bishop the other day, the person has the ability to cause you to rise up. You know, there are some people that can speak, and you just want to do. So the person begins to growl in the microphone, God can do all things, he can, and they sort out, you just get up, and you want to, but this same person has encouraged you, will go home, on the way home begins to slap his wife. The children are afraid of him. So he has a gift. But spirituality is new. But what we are believing God for that we will become is a people. Spirituality is when you become more like Jesus. When you put away your wicked ways. When you accept that you're not perfect. When you just want to be like Jesus. That is spirituality. You can be gifted and carry no anointing. But you cannot become more spiritual without anointing. Do we understand the difference? So sometimes you want to listen to certain people, you want to do certain things, you want to go to certain conferences, and the people are using gift, no spirituality. Look, develop your own spirituality. That is what wisdom will ask that you do. Become a better person, become more like Jesus. There has to be a paradigm shift. I'm not interested in empty words. One of the first gifts of the Spirit I asked God for was discernment of spirit. So I'm not listening to what you're saying. I'm listening to what God is saying. Do you understand that? So you can stand here and preach the most fanciful message. But if your life is totally out of sync, then it's empty words. But you can stand here and just even stammer through a sermon. But as you stammer, God is reminding you about Moses in the Bible and his relationship with Moses the stutterer. And the Holy Spirit is speaking. Brother, that's what we're looking for. Spirituality, not gift. We don't care about gift. I was telling Bishop, I said nobody comes here to preach. I don't invite anybody. So if you see any guest minister, know that they've invited themselves. Because I'm not interested in guest ministers. If we will develop ourselves, there are enough of us here that can hear from God, become better people, and share. Every time someone has come up to hold a microphone, whether it's 5 minutes to talk about their favorite Bible passage, or even just to give us the Bible passage, we are blessed somehow. So why do we need to go and be looking for gifts? No. I don't look for gifts. My prayer is that our spirituality will develop. In this church, we'll become more like Jesus. Romans 11:29 says, the gifts and callings of God are irrevocable. But we're believing God for revelation. You read the Bible, and the Holy Spirit will give you revelation. That way you will learn how to behave. When you get closer to the Holy Spirit, and that's why we're fasting, Proverbs 4:7, get wisdom. Wisdom is the principal thing. That's all we're asking God for. And if we ask sincerely, and like it's saying in Ephesians 1:17, and he gives to us, brethren, our story will change. You will suddenly find a man that is given to violence. He's calm. In fact, you won't believe. You will test him in many ways. Because the greatest, for me, the greatest miracle is a changed life. That is the greatest miracle. When you know Jesus has come in, a man that is given to gossip, a man that's given to distortion, suddenly is given to the truth. You must know that there is a God. So when we begin to backslide and we begin to get a little empty, it is because our relationship with the Holy Spirit is dwindling. This God is so, God is such an awesome God that he can excite you from now till you die with revelation. When you read the Bible, somebody called me one day. I said, oh, I should have slept at 11. This was about 12:30. I should have slept at 11 because I'm getting up at 4. And because I know the person, I said, go and read your Bible. The person said, why? I said, you will sleep when you start reading your Bible. Somebody else called and said they can't sleep. I said, go and pray. Because some people in the place of prayer, that's where they sleep. But for others, if you have to sleep at 11 and you pick up your Bible at 5 to 11, that's a dangerous thing. Because God begins to bless you with revelation. You may read that Bible till 4 in the morning and not realize. Do we understand that? My prayer is that there must be a paradigm shift. We must get to the place where we're depending on the Holy Spirit. When you depend on the Holy Spirit, like it says in John chapter 3, verse 30, you will decrease. He must increase. And as he increases, brethren, you, the power, the glory, the joy that will come becomes unbelievable. You learn to depend on God. That's why I love Psalm 109, verse 4. Let's look at Psalm 109. Let's read the first 4 verses and bring this word to an end. Psalm 109. I'll read the first 4 verses. I love the end of verse 4. I use it to encourage myself regularly. Psalm 109 from verse 1. The Bible says, do not keep silent, O God, of my praise, for the mouth of the wicked and the mouth of the deceitful have opened against me. And like I was explaining to the church, when we use this as a prayer point, when the Bible talks about the mouth of the wicked and the mouth of the deceitful, it's not talking about man. It's talking about man, circumstances, and situations. The mouth of the wicked could be a curse attempting to work against you. Could be poverty trying to hug you. Could be frustration trying to become very close to you. It says the mouth of the wicked, the mouth of the deceitful have opened against me. They have spoken against me with a lying tongue because circumstances speak. They have also surrounded me with words of hatred and fought against me without a cause. Verse 4 says, in return for my love, they are my accusers, but I give myself to prayer. If you are not spiritual, you will fight them back. If you are not spiritual, you will speak evil about them. If you are not spiritual, you will tell everybody that cares to know that these people are evil, they are wicked. I loved them, I see how they repaid me back. But if you have an understanding of life, you get into the place of prayer. Brethren, there is no situation that cannot be broken in the place of prayer. There's no situation that God cannot turn the right side up in the place of prayer. There is no answer to any negative situation that God cannot give in the place of prayer. So as you become more spiritual through revelation, through a deeper walk with God, your story changes. You that are known, you know, recently I got a text. And I read the text. And it was from one of my sons. And he says to me, do you know this man? So I reply and I tell him the man, I tell him the man's position and title to show him that I know the man. I say, yeah, I know him very well. He's a good friend of mine. So he's grateful. He says he's looking for a job and that man can help. And then he goes on to explain that in the line of the kind of work he's looking for, people have godfathers. And their godfathers look after them. You know? So I saw that thing and he's a Christian, and a lot of things went through my mind, you know? People have godfathers. Their godfathers look after them. You're a Christian. I wanted to send him a reply and say, God is your father, so he's your godfather. He will look after you there. And then I walk into a bank. And as I walk into the bank, I see one of the ministers in the church here. And because it's on my mind, and we start talking, I share the story with him because he shares a story with me. And he tells me about the company where he works and all the things that are happening and all kinds of strange things happening. Another company has bought them over. People are jostling for position. And he says he has just remained calm. He says when the new structure came out, they had placed him well. Not they, but God. He didn't jostle for position. So I told him about this other young fellow and how he spoke about a godfather. And I realized that the difference between two of them is revelation. One knows the God he serves. One knows that if he will give himself to prayer, things will happen. When you pray in the realm of the spirit, there is a reorganization with a manifestation in the physical. The manifestation in the physical you see now is because others have tried to rearrange things in the realm of the spirit against you. Others have spoken evil words. You won't have children. Who says, are they God? Lamentations 3:37 says, who is it that speaks and it comes to pass when God has not ordained it? So I get into the realm of the spirit, and then God helps me cancel things. That is why we pray. So I have a need. I take this need to God. I first praise God. You know, like the Bible says, he knows what you need before you ask. Even before you pray, he has answered, because he knows everything. So why are you killing yourself, fighting in the physical, looking for a godfather, when God is your father? So after I spoke to the pastor, I sent him, I told him the story, I showed him the text. I sent the boy a reply. I says, God is your father. He's your godfather. So he sends me a smiley face. He says, yes, I know. But still help me. Ha! Huh? A lack of revelation. But still help you what? After all of that, is God not bigger than the man that you want me to introduce you to? Yes, you know, but you know, help me so the lions can fall onto me in pleasant places. No. Only God makes the lions fall onto you in pleasant places. The man can see you, take you. Brethren, I'll tell you one story. I don't want to tell stories. Let's bring this word to an end so we can pray. But I'll tell you one story. Just one. Two friends of mine, one has connections with, they're big men. So two big men have connections. One of them has connections with a big man that the other one wants. A has connections with C. B wants that connection. So A says to B, let's go. So he takes B. He takes C because C has told him, or he takes B because B has told A that he just wants to meet C. He doesn't tell him why. But he says, oh, let's go, let's go. So they get there. So B begins to explain how C can help him. And A is just pretending to be an onlooker. And then they go. After they go, A calls C. Says, don't mind that boy. What he wants, I will do for you. Can you imagine? So he blocked. He blocked B. Two very good friends. When B found out what had happened, because he saw A doing the business that they discussed with that man, he said, what happened? Eli said, the man said I should do it. Well, then, if you trust man, you will fail. It doesn't matter who the man is, but if you trust God, you can never fail. So Revelation says, I better know God. I better give myself to prayer. I better be led by the Holy Spirit, because only God can help me. 2 Corinthians 10, and we begin to bring this story to an end. 2 Corinthians 10. Brother, I wish. No, it's okay. I tell us story after story on the power of God. God answers prayers. And my prayer, the prayer I am praying now, I'm praying many prayers. One of the prayers I'm praying now is that God in his mercy should answer prayers that will be obvious for all to see, especially those that are cynical. There are some that are cynical. Oh, you've been doing this for years, yes. You've been doing that, yes, yes. Where are the results? No, you will see results in Jesus' name. If we'll be led by the Holy Spirit, if wisdom will come, God says he will give us. If we'll receive this wisdom, things must change. Your prayer life must change. The wisest prayer a man can pray is to ask the Holy Spirit what God wants him to pray, not to take your prayers to God. If you pray what God wants you to pray, there must be miracles. Anna wanted a son. God wanted a judge. The Holy Spirit must have spoken to her. And she prayed a strange prayer. God, give me a son, I'll give him back to you. God gave her a son, and she paid her vow. God says, I'll give you 5 more. Brethren, God will do for you more than you can ask, think, or imagine if you will yield to him. If you will kill your flesh, if you will let the Holy Spirit lead you. Let's just read 2 more portions of the Bible and then we'll pray. The Bible says, for though we walk in the flesh, 2 Corinthians 10, 3-6, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Don't fight that person. Get into the place of prayer. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God to pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. And being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. We walk in the flesh, yes. Well, we don't war according to the flesh. We're in this world, but we're not of this world. We don't do things the way of the world. We don't lobby men because we want position. We're not interested in position. The only position we want is to be in God's good books, is to dwell in the secret place of the Most High, to hide under the shadow of the Almighty. If you can get in there, oh, everything else is all right. They can war against you, but they will never win. They can speak against you, but their words will be empty. Because God has your back. God will look after you. And when God blesses you, no man can pull you down. So you're not in competition with anybody else. Your only competition is to please God, to know God, to serve God, and to make sure you're led by the Holy Spirit. That is wisdom. That is revelation. And God is giving that to us today. So if you still get angry, you still fight, you've missed it totally. Your spirituality is nil. But daily we must increase our spirituality. Because as you increase your spirituality, as you get closer to God, brethren, breaking through becomes easier. Breaking through becomes easier. We must be better people. A little change will bring about great glory. Just a little paradigm shift, a little repositioning, and our story will change. It says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, will give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. We don't know who we are. That is why we have high blood pressure. That is why we struggle. That is why we carry offense. Let's bow our heads, take ourselves to God. If we have Jesus as our Lord and Savior, there must be a paradigm shift. The story changes today. We don't fight anybody. We're not threatened by anybody. Nobody can give us a complex. God has His own plans for us. God has His own plans for us. And every life is bespoke. Let's take ourselves to God and thank Him. Because He has said that even before He formed us in the womb, He knew us. Before we were born, He sanctified us. He has a purpose for every life. No one can steal God's glory in my life. It talks about the Father of glory. The Father of glory. If I will stay with the Father of glory, glory must rest on me. Must rest on my wife. Must rest on the children God has blessed us with. But it's in the place of prayer. Brethren, take every situation that is speaking against you. Let's take every such situation to God. Every single situation speaking against us. In the place of prayer, things must change. There's a paradigm shift. Our thinking has changed. Our focus has changed. We desire to get closer to God. Father, we thank You, especially if we have Jesus as our Lord and Savior. The days of being obnoxious come to an end. The days of being violent in the flesh come to an end. The days of carrying unforgiveness come to an end. The days of not being fresh come to an end. The days of not praying come to an end. The days of the flesh leading us come to an end. We will get wisdom. We will receive as God gives us in the name of Jesus. And let's pray for ourselves. Pray for ourselves. Pray for our loved ones. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to us, because we position ourselves right, the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, simply because of mercy. We've lost too many things in life because we were not wise. We've lost blessings that God gave us because we were not wise. We've lost position, spiritual positioning in life, because we did it in the flesh. Things have changed. We don't argue with anybody anymore. We don't fight anybody. We settle matters in the place of prayer. God answers prayers. Father, we bless You. For those of us that have Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are grateful. We thank You for a paradigm shift this day. We refuse to go back to the old. We press forward. Father, for those that don't have Jesus as their Lord and Savior, we ask that the Holy Spirit will give them wisdom to invite Jesus into their lives, into their circumstances, that it must be well with them. And Daddy, by reason of Your mercy, use our lives to show those that are cynical that You still answer prayers. Thank You for great mercy. And we ask that our times of praise will be more than our times of asking when we pray. Daddy, thank You. In Jesus' powerful name, we have prayed. Amen. Someone say, thank you, Jesus.
We're his portion and he's our prize, drawn to redemption.